master by Dyer Center. This is Gabby. She'll be talking today about scalar. I guess that's all I really need to say. So go ahead, Gabby.
All right, so I'm going to give you guys an introduction to Scalar, which is a digital exhibit building website. So I'm just going to tell you kind of what it's about, how to do some basic things in it, and at the end of the PowerPoint, I also have some resources for you guys if you want to look more into it after this. So what is Scalar? It's a free open source digital exhibit building and publishing platform that was created by the University of Southern California's Alliance for Networking and Visual Culture. So it's best used for small to moderate amounts of structured content. And generally, if you look at examples on the website, it gives you text-heavy kind of examples, but you can do a lot of different things. You can, it's a really versatile platform. So the most prominent features of Scalar is it's built to be used by people of varying degrees of technical ability. So if you don't know a lot about computer stuff, you can use it. You can make a pretty simplistic one without much hassle. Or if you do have technical ability or want to learn technical ability, you can do a lot of cool customizations with JavaScript and CSS. It also has a flexible structure, so that means that you can make a lot of different kinds of paths throughout your exhibit. To make your project kind of, I don't know how to say this, but like it's like you can, they say on the website anything can do anything to anything, which is kind of like a weird saying, but it's true. Because you can, you know, tag things and you can make a path and you can also annotate things, and all of those things can mix together in any way you want. It has an open API. Which basically means that it shares data with a lot of different archives and websites. So you can get things from different Omeka sites on there, you can get things from SoundCloud, Vimeo, YouTube. It's a pretty open platform. And then also, again, you have custom styling, so if you know any CSS, you can style your pages however you would like with that. And I'm also going to talk about Scalar versus Omeka, because they're kind of similar things, but they do different things. So for Scalar, it's small to moderate amounts of content, and for Omeka, you would put large amounts of content. So if you had a project like the Wide Wide World Digital Edition, which we have at the Iris Center, that has a lot of different scans of books and different kinds of content, like videos and XML pages and things like that. So you don't want to put a ton of things in the Scalar like you would Omeka. And a good metaphor for Scalar is kind of like it's a curated art gallery, more like it's a set of content that's like specific to what you want to show people, where Omeka is more like a museum collection where you have a lot of different things and they belong to a bunch of different categories. Scalar is not as structured as Omeka. Omeka has a specific hierarchical structure. So you have like collections, data trees, those kind of things in Omeka, like automatically built into its system, where Scalar, you kind of have to manually organize your content. And Scalar, the nice thing about Scalar for smaller projects is that it's hosted through USC, so you don't have to have your own server for it. Where Omeka, you normally would use your own university server. Like an SAUV, our Omeka sites are run through the university. So these are the different types of media you can put in Scalar. As you can see, it's a lot of different things you can put in there. So there's different, you can put maps in there, different kinds of audio files, a lot of different images, text, video, those kinds of things. And you can incorporate it however you'd like within your exhibit. So I'm going to show you guys an example project of a Scalar site. So for Dr. Despain's Literature and Technology class, this was me and two other people in the class's final presentation. So we had three early feminist texts and we wanted to talk about intersectionality and the different ways that these three texts talk about issues of like motherhood, feminine identity, that kind of thing. So what we did was, using Scalar, we kind of made an intersectional site where you can, the paths are all connected, so you can kind of click around it as you'd like. There's no set path. And this is an image that we made in Photoshop. And you can see that this has a lot of text in it. And we also have hyperlinks to the different pages within the introduction. So we can see we made media galleries for each of the individual books pages. So this is the media gallery for Her Land. And it has different media put in here. And you can actually click and it'll take you to the image. And what the coolest thing about Scalar is we were able to do this intersectionality page that had a structured media gallery. So we could show all of the intersections of themes that we saw within each of the novels and put them on one page. And so you could click around through all these themes. And we used the book scanner that's in the Iris Center and scanned quotes from each of the books that we thought worked with these themes. So if you click on this, you can see the scan, and we also have annotations for each of the images explaining why we put this quote there, what it means to in context of the other quotes too. So this is just one example of the things you can do. And as you can see, we have background images. We have a lot of different things going on here. And you don't have to do that for your page, but it just we wanted to make it pretty, basically. So going back to this. So the most important parts, I think, to me, whenever I started using Scalar, was figuring out the paths, tagging, and how to add media. So paths are the ways that you link your pages together and the way that the people who are viewing your exhibit will click through all your different pages and content. Media is all of the content you're going to upload, and you can upload things through Scalar, which I'm going to show you. And tagging is the way you group all the media you put together. So that structured media gallery, we used a lot of tags to put all of those things on the same page. So here is the link to the Scalar site that I made for this brown bag, if you'd like to go to it. So this is a just standard book front page. So you have a title, a subtitle, it says the name, and this is, so I put a path to this front page to the page we're going to start on. And just to show you how, sorry, I thought I was going to sneeze, kind of how editing the book works. I did sneeze. So this is what your account looks like on Scalar. Oh, sorry about that. So you can see your email, your full name, all of that kind of stuff, and then you can see all of your books. And so you can edit your book properties through your dashboard. So you have your title, subtitle, you can add a description, you can specialize your URI segments, so that's just the part of the URL that makes it the Scalar site specific to what you're doing. And then you can also change the background image and the thumbnail image of your projects here. And this is where custom styling comes in, so you can customize the front of your page too if you'd like to, with JavaScript or CSS. And this is cool because you can select also the scope of your page, of your exhibit, so you can say it's a book, an article, or a project. So each thing would kind of indicate what you're doing. And then you can also add multiple users to your page. So if you wanted to collaborate with somebody else on your exhibit, you could add them and you both can work on your pages together. And then you can make your page available to the public. And you can make it so others can request to join your book and things like that. And then it also shows you all of the pages that are in your project too, and the media relationships and that kind of thing. Let me go back. So let's go to the media gallery. So this is just an example, another example of something you can do with the media gallery. So I have a video from YouTube. I have a piece of an image from Omeka that I downloaded from the Wide World Omeka site. And then I have a podcast from SoundCloud that I downloaded. And so down here you can see that all of the things that show up on this page, I had to tag it to organize it on this page. So you have to make a tag of whatever media content you want in your media gallery. And something that's really cool if you're working with Omeka sites, so if we go to the page for this image that I got from Omeka, you can see that it transfers all of the Dublin Core metadata over from Omeka, so you can see the title, description, location, source, subject, the unique identifier for where it came from, and that kind of thing. And then it makes it its own page in your Scalar. See that there. You can also do local media files, so if you have images on your computer that you'd like to use, or videos, or anything like that. And you can also go to do internet media files, which would be, you would search a URL. So say you found an image at Google you wanted to use, you could copy and paste the URL for that image and put it into your Scalar image. So Scalar, a lot of it is, I think it's a really cool digital humanities tool just because you have to do so much tinkering with it. It's a lot of it really is you kind of figuring out how you want things to look and tagging different things and to see how that works. So if we go to the structured media gallery, so on this page, I put my media gallery into a different gallery, so if we had multiple ones, like that intersectionality page I showed you before, it would, all of those would appear on the same page and you could click around through them and you can see all the thumbnails for all the content too. You can do, we go into editing. There's a lot of different types of pages you can make in Scalar. So you could do, down here you can see, all the general ones, so you can make a basic page where text and media kind of go together freely, so you could have like text and then have an image over here, or whatever you want for that page. It's more of like a freeform page. Image header, so this one would be, you have an image at the top of your page with a title and then have text beneath it with other images that you'd like in there. And then splash and book splash are cover screen sections for basically like the beginning of your book or project that would just say the title and have an image. And the media gallery I already showed you how you make a media gallery is you click this, say you want to make this page a media gallery, and then you'd go to tags. And then you would go to all of the media you want, and you'd say add tags to this page is tagged by, and you'd click that. And then you'd select whatever media you want in there. And then we have the structured media gallery, which is the page it is right now, where it has multiple thumbnails and media galleries in there. And this is like a really cool thing that it has. You can put a Google map in there, and so the Google map is at the would be at the top of your screen, and each page in your project would be a place on the map. So in the page, you can go to this metadata. So say this is the page you want to make a point on the map. you'd go to this metadata tab and you click add additional metadata, and then you can go to there is a I think you can add the coordinates for your whatever point on the map you want, and it'll put it into the map on the front of the page. And then you would tag this page to the map page. I have an example of that I can show you too in a few minutes. And then you can do a Google map, and you can also do a timeline. So I haven't actually worked much with timelines in Scalar. And you can see that all of these layouts have a learn more button, so you could click this and learn how to do that for your own project. And a lot of, so like the timeline, the map, a lot of it would be putting metadata into your project. And so paths, so you can make this, I could make this a path to, let's say I wanted to make it also a path to my media gallery. So if I did that and I hit save to view, I could also go, before I could go back with begin button, so I can go back and forth between these pages now. And you can also annotate different types of media. So if you wanted to annotate something, you would make, you would hit this, this plus button is a new page. So say I wanted to annotate that image from the Wide Wide World website. So book cover, this is a book cover. Not very creative, but. So you'd say that, and then you go to relationships, and you'd say, this page is an annotation for this piece of content. So, this is to see how big you want your annotation to be over, if you hover over it in the books thing. So, so it shows up on this, and then you can see it if you hover over the image. Let's go back to this. And you can also make different pages a comment for another page. So it's the same thing as the annotations, where you'd make a separate page, you'd add your comment, and then you'd select the type, the media you wanted it, this page to comment on. And then tagging is how you group different pieces of media together. So if you all want them to be on the same page, you would make this page, so you'd make this page a tag of whatever page you wanted it to be on. And you do that for whatever media you wanted to be on a certain page. And then here's all the different styling options you can do. So you can stylize the thumbnail image for this page. You can stylize the key image for this page, which would be if you did any of the image header, splash, or book splash layouts. So if you had like an image at the top of the page, that's where you'd edit it if you choose the image. So you have to, one of the things about Scalar is you have to kind of have all your content in there uploaded before you can really mess around with it. So if you have a set, if you have a few set images or videos or audio or anything like that, it'd be best to, like, whenever you start your Scalar page, upload all of them and then organize them however you'd like into pages. And then here you can mess with the CSS. So if you, it actually has some set CSS parameters that you can add into there already. So if you wanted to add this, you can insert it into there and save and view, so a text content area to full width. So if I had a lot of writing on this page, like it went all the way over, it'd like kind of even it out on the page. And then you can also do the same with JavaScript, except for it doesn't have any of the ones like it has for CSS. You can't insert, it doesn't have any like pre-insert things you can put in there. And then here, you can put audio files into your, you can also put audio files into your page too for the styling. And then you have the properties, you can make the page visible or hidden, and you can say the different type of content it is. So you can say it's book content, so it's part of your main exhibit, it's either commentary, it's review, or I'm not sure what term it means, but yeah, so those are all the different content types you can do. And here's all the here's all the metadata you can use. So here are all the Dublin Core terms you can put in there. Here are all the different art terms you can put in there, or photo metadata, so you can kind of, you can put all of these things, like to tag all of your items too. That tag. So yeah, I'm going to show you guys an example since I kind of went faster than I thought I would. Let me show you this too. Sorry, I'm a little all over the place. So if you hit index over here for your website, it shows you all of the paths, all of your pages, all of your media, all of the tags, annotations, and comments. So this is kind of where you would find all your media. So if you're trying to find something, this is the place to look at for. So if we go to account, so if you go to accounting, you can see all of your books. So I'm going to show you an example of the map I was talking about. So this was another project I did for, I took a Toni Morrison class last semester. This was my final project for that. And I was mapping the different places within Toni Morrison's book, Paradise. And so this is what the map looks like. And so each page, so I have a page for each of the towns that I mapped. And each page is a place on the map. So I can click on this and go to the page for that. Which is pretty cool. So this is this on this page, so the page for this particular town is where I would put the metadata for the coordinates of where I wanted it to be. Are there any like questions that you guys have, or anything you guys want to know more specifically about Scalar that I could help you with? Lindsay was, I know you were thinking of using Scalar for your project.
I think now it's just going to be a matter of uploading everything and playing.
Yeah, so this is definitely a platform where there's a lot of playing around with it. And even like if you read through all the tutorials and stuff, you can still get kind of lost in the weeds. So.
That's why I have your email.
Anything else? Any other questions? Yes.
I'm looking at the page called Dashboard.
Mm-hmm.
Is that the page you started from to show us the different functions?
Yes.
So if we don't have a book to manage and we wanted to experiment with this,
mm-hmm.
what would be a procedure?
So you go to your dashboard and you hit new book title down at the bottom where it says my books. And you title it whatever you'd want. So just say, actually I can make it. So you title it whatever you want and then you click the I'm not a robot thing and then you click create and then it would show up in your books and then you could click on the link to it.
Thank you. I'm not seeing where you check on my book. is that the drop-down, select a book to manage?
Are you on the My Accounts on the dashboard?
I'm on Book Property, so I'll go to My Account.
Yeah, so you, on My Account is where you create the new book.
Okay, I'm not a robot. So if we create a book, is it visible to anyone else?
So sharing is where you can manage the availability settings, so in the make URL public, you would hit, if you didn't want anybody to see it, you'd say no, so no one could look up your URL or anything like that to your book.
Okay.
Or a hit yes if you want to share it with people.
Does Scalar have to be downloaded before it's usable, or can one start from this page, My Account?
You can start from that page. So it's all on USC's server, so this is just like a web page posted by that server that they allow people to create new books and stuff upon it.
So we make up a URL on the line that says HTTP website under My Account.
No, that's not for, I think that's if you have like a website for yourself, like for your own project. So if this was a part of this Scalar project was a part of a bigger project, I think you put that there, but I'm not 100% sure. So if you go
that
to
seems
Book Properties, that's where you can, so under, there's title, subtitle, description, and the URI segment is where you can edit your URL. So if I wanted to change this URI segment to just Tony, so if I wanted to change that just to Tony Morrison, I could do that and then hit save down at the bottom.
Apparently someone already has a Tony Morrison, because they put Tony Morrison dash one.
And that's not surprising. and I can also go to my PowerPoint. So here are the further resources. So here is, we're gonna put these Google slides on the IRIS blog. So you guys can look it up later if you want to mess around with Scalar, and here are some resources I put for you. So the University of Illinois Library has like a whole like introduction to Scalar. It's much more in depth than what I'm telling you. So if you wanted to go through that, it also steps you through the process too. And then here are other Scalar pages that you can look at for examples and ideas. So here are all my pages, and then here are just some examples they have. So this, I think I've looked through this one before, and it's pretty text heavy. So yeah, it has a lot of different kinds of text, and then it has a table. They're like, I think they use CSS to do this in Scalar, because this is not something Scalar just does. So this is an example of how you could use CSS in your project. And they have all of the different images on the side, and mixes in media with text in that way. So
I just accidentally created two books.
Mm-hmm.
How do I delete one?
So for that, you can go back to your account.
Mm-hmm.
I've never tried to delete a book before, so I'm not sure.
I'll try Googling it.
I'll fix it together. Dashboard.
there's a clear button, but that didn't do it. I've still got two titles here.
Okay.
It says if you go to the All Books tab, that includes a delete function. But in order to see that, you have to be a super user.
I mean, if you have like multiple books, even if you don't want one, you can just ignore one. It doesn't like, really do anything to your site or like maybe whatever book you're working on, like weird or anything. Because you know, obviously, you have multiple books, and it's fine. Yeah, I'm not sure how you delete it. Maybe.
You can also send an email to a Scalar admin to request the deletion of a book.
Yeah, because maybe as like just a normal Scalar user, you're not a super user, so you wouldn't be able to delete things like
right.
that. Anything else?
So I'd like to understand a little more.
Okay.
Once I've created a book, you were taking us through different steps to
mm-hmm.
upload and link things. Now that I have a book created, how would I get to it and what would I do next?
So on your account, so click on, go to the My Book section and just click on whatever book you want to work on. So I'll click on Scalar Front Bag.
Okay.
And that, and if you don't have anything, it'll just pull up a blank page.
Right.
And so this little pencil is the editing tool. And so you can then go down and select whatever layout you want. So if you want the front of your book to be a book splash, slash, image header, or just a basic one, you can choose that or actually any of the ones you want to do. So you do that first. And then you can upload this plus button. Well, first. The plus button in the upper right corner is adding a page, so if you want to add a different page, you can do that. And then it asks you for a title description. You can put all your content in the page and select what kind of page it wants in the layout section. And then to link that page to your first page, you go to Relationships, and you hit Path, and then choose something it contains. So I'm going to say, this page I'm making goes to my media gallery. So I'm just going to say, example. And then so I do that. So whenever I create this page, I can then go to my media gallery from it. So that's how Paths works. It links different pages together so you can scroll through the website. And then to download content, you can go to the little arrow button in the upper right corner. And then you can download from any of these archives, from Omeka site, SoundCloud. So if I go to other archives, and I just go to YouTube.
Gabby, which icon was it?
It's the...
download icon?
It's the download icon. It's the arrow with the little box underneath it. And you hover over it, and you can go through all the different things. Or you can do a hit local media file, and then you can then choose a file from your computer that you want to upload.
Which one's local?
So you go to the download thing and hover over it, and then you can go down to local.
Does that mean files that are on the computer system you're working from
mm-hmm.
and you can browse out like you were attaching an email attachment somewhere?
Yes. So you'd hit local and this is the local, and then you could choose any file from your computer that you want to. And then you can also do internet media files. So if you have like the web address to a certain image, you can then import that image from the web address. And so, say you have a piece of content and you want to put it on this page you made. So I'm going to go to my index, and I'm going to go to my pages, And go to the example page. And so I'm going to edit this example page. And I'm just going to make it a basic type of page. And then I'm going to go to... and it contains, and then you can hit the add content thing, and then you click whatever page you want it to link to. And you can have it link to multiple pages as well. It doesn't just have to be one page. So if you wanted to, if you wanted all of your pages to link up to each other, you could make them all paths to each other. And then at the bottom of your page, it will have all of the links to the paths. So then you can click it and go to the different pages. I mean, there are a lot of different things you can do with Scalar, but that's just kind of the basics.
Cool.
Is there a certain project you're wanting to work on, or is this...
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I have a lot of American Indian material from the Pacific Northwest Coast.
Okay.
And a lot of it is audio and video, so I think Omeka might be better from what you said.
Mm-hmm.
Is there some gigabyte limit for Scalar that you would suggest in order to measure one's material to choose Omeka or Scalar?
I think the advice I'd give is, so let me go to like my example page, and I'll show you all of the media we have on there. So for this page, we had quite a bit of like media, like we had quite a bit of pages too, like we had a bunch of book scans. So I don't know, like in gigabytes or anything like that, like what you put in there. I'd say if it's gonna be like, is it gonna be like a one-time exhibit kind of thing, or is it an ongoing project?
Ongoing.
So yeah, for that I'd recommend Omeka, just because it's easier to manage files and things in Omeka, and it already has a kind of a like hierarchical structure, so it will put it in collections and different things and kind of put your media into where you want it to be.
Do you teach Omeka as part of the Iris Center initiatives?
Yes.
Yeah.
Are you the one, Gabby, who does that?
No, Omeka is not necessarily my strong suit. It's more Ben, who works with Ben and Katie work with Omeka.
What's your name?
Ben.
Ben, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. I can help you with setting up Omeka. Well, we can help you with setting up Omeka.
Just as a matter of setting an appointment in the Iris Lab, is that how you proceed?
Yes,
yeah. So if you email us, we can set up an appointment and talk to you about what platform would work best.
Mm-hmm.
From what it sounds like Omeka is best from my point of view as well. I'm trying to find now if there is any data limit for Scalar, and I'm not finding anything immediately.
Yeah, like I don't know if there's a data limit, but at some point it'd become unmanageable because you kind of have to organize your content yourself.
Right, whereas Omeka kind of organized it for you.
Yeah. So like,
sort of.
So this is more like if you had like a certain specific project you wanted to say, like exhibit, say like, oh, this is an idea I have, this is all the content, this
mm-hmm.
is like, you know what I'm talking about, kind of like for, you know, final projects or digital exhibits. I'm going to be using Scalar for, I'm an ERCA associate, so
yeah.
For my final project for that, I'm using Scalar just because it's like a one-and-done type project.
Yeah. All right, and I have one more question, if I could. These two platforms, are they available to the public, or are they available to us because we're working through the SIUE? Server or sponsorship?
Scalar is available to everybody everywhere, basically, if you make an account. There's no, like, you don't have to be a part of a university or anything like that. Omeka, I think you have to pay for it, but we have it through the university, so
Omeka, you have to have your own server to use it. But we have a system in place now where we can create Omeka sites for people.
So those people would have to ask for additional storage space if they needed it? Is that so?
Yes, but I don't think that would be an issue because we it's run through the SAE servers and we've never run into a data size issue with that.
And let's say that since I'm, you know, older and years pass and I expect I will expire someday like all people do, what will happen to the Omeka project that I created? Will it sit on the internet forever or will it expire because no one is maintaining it, or do I have to appoint someone in future, in the next generation, to manage it?
Yeah, I mean that's an issue with every digital project ever.
Yeah.
For us at least, it would still be part of the Iris Center if you retired, and we could at least keep it up. Mm-hmm. We wouldn't obviously be adding to it at all.
Right.
Or doing anything to it, but
we could update the software and make sure it's still usable for people who want to increase the collection.
Right.
Alright, and then Omeka is available, the content of both Omeka and Scalar are available to anyone who arrives at these URLs, or does it require some membership to access the material?
I think both of these, if you, because like Omeka, you would make a website front, so I can actually show you an example of Omeka. So this is the Wide Wide World's Omeka site. This is the back end of it. So this is the website where you add content and items and, you know, there's a collection tree and all that fun stuff. Mm-hmm. So you can see we have like over 3,000 items. So there's like a lot of content on this website.
And we're still adding to it.
Yeah. So if you go just to the URL that's not an admin URL, this is the front end. So this is the actual website that people would click around and see. And Omeka takes a little bit more technical skill, I think, too, because like if you want to make a front end, you have to know, you know, web design and that kind of thing.
Yes and no. I mean, if you want it to look nice, yes.
Yeah. All right.
There's default Omeka themes that don't look very nice, in my personal opinion.
What?
They exist, so.
Does your staff, do you know, and the people that work with you, how to design them with the necessary knowledge?
Yeah, I mean, I've done, like, multiple Omeka sites design.
Generally for projects in the Iris Center, you can write in, if you're writing grant or something, you can write in time for web development help.
Right.
To have someone like specifically work on your project for a certain period of time for the week.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
In any grant one would write, right? Is that what you mean? I didn't quite understand what grant. Any grant?
Well, I'm just saying if you're applying for grant, because generally, or at least have been an IS times purchased, generally people have written us into grants to work specifically on their projects. We can give you basic level help, but if, for example, you're writing for a grant for this project, you would, if you wanted Ben's help to devise the front of your website for maybe 5 hours a week, you could write him into that grant, and then he could dedicate actual like period of his work hours to that, and so
right.
just kind of helping us.
Right, because yeah. I can help a little bit, but the way my job is, like, I can't create a website. Okay.